Hey, today we're going to talk about steel heat treating. We're going to heat treat in our Even Heat and Paragon ovens both. We're going to use aluminum plates. And we have Bill Nye, the science guy, going to help us with our heat treat steel. These are chrome carbides, vanadium carbides, steel lattice. Bill Nye. So let's get into this tool wrap. Comes in all different kinds. It's usually 02,000 thick. It's usually sharp as a razor and will probably cut myself before this is done. If you just run your fingers right along the edge, you're gonna draw blood just about every time. I don't know that I've ever wrapped a knife and not drawn blood. So it comes in 309 and 321 for the knife guys. There's different formulas of heat treat steel, and they respond to different temperatures. Oddly, 309 is the higher temperature heat treat or tool wrap. And that will, depending upon the manufacturer, however it's rated, will handle up to 2100 Fahrenheit up to 2350 Fahrenheit, okay? So we're using type 309 today because this CPM 154 knife, we've got two of them, heat treats at around 1950 on the recipe that we're going to use, 1950 Fahrenheit. So we've got this 309 type. 321 tool wrap looks identical. You can't tell it by looking at it. That's going to be rated to about 1600-1700 degrees for carbon steels. Typically tool shops, machine shops, that kind of thing will use it for 01 or W2 or some of the other tool steels. Simpler carbon steels that tend to heat treat around 1550 Fahrenheit. The stainless steels usually all go back to 440C ATS 34 derivatives. There's different ones, but they tend to heat treat around 1900, 1925, 1950, depending upon the recipe that you're using. Today we're going to bring this up to around 1440, and we're going to pause. We'll put it in our oven. We'll ramp it all the way up to around 1440, full speed, as fast as the oven will go. We'll hold it there for about 10 minutes and soak it. And that's at one temperature that matters, and it kind of helps get things going. Then we're going to run it full speed up to 1950 Fahrenheit, and we'll soak it for around 20-25 minutes. You'll find in heat treat recipes that they'll tell you to soak it for longer. But this is pretty thin steel, and so we're going to be fine around 20-25 minutes. We'll pull it out, burning hot. We'll put it in between these plates that we've got, aluminum plates, and there's nothing special about these. They're just aluminum plate. They're about an inch thick, and they're wide enough to put the envelope and everything in between the plates. So we'll put the knife there. If this was wrapped in an envelope, we'll put it in there. We'll put another piece of aluminum on there. And then we'll just shoot compressed air in around there, and in about 30 seconds the quench is done, and then we'll draw it back. We'll temper it once that blade is cooled off the room temperature. We'll temper it at 350 or 400 for a couple hours twice. Now we're going to try and find some dry ice around here, and we'll give it a quick cryo with dry ice. We don't have any liquid nitrogen, but we'll give that going, and we'll see you in a minute. Okay, so we've got two options on our tool wrap. This is, we just rolled this out bulk that we have. We also sell it in rolls. And then we sell these pre-made pouches. And these are all folded up. They're pretty cool. They're more expensive than the bulk, but they're quick, easy, and fast. So we've got this one. Dustin, our production guy, is working on a new Bally. He's got this blade all ready to heat treat, and so the whole deal with this is we drop that in. Let me see what I'm doing here. Get that in the pouch. Fold it over. A lot of heat treat foil tool wrap comes with these little rollers. I can't ever seem to make them work. There, we did that. I tend to use a hammer and just tap over the edge. Now you can double fold that, but there's no air getting in there. The main thing is you just want to keep the air out. Now some guys will tell you that they put in a piece of paper, they put in a cigarette butt, they'll put twigs, they'll put whatever inside of the pouch to burn up any excess oxygen. I've done it both ways. I can't tell the difference. I don't think the decarb from the available small amount of oxygen in there is going to significantly affect anything. What I have found is that if you put some stuff in there and different things, it's easier to clean up the heat treat patina that remains on the blade when you pull it back out. So that's up to you. No one's proven it one way or another. There's a lot of strong feelings about it. If you want to put something in there, by all means, put something in there. It's not going to hurt anything. If you don't want to, well, maybe that's okay too. So that's your call. I don't anymore. I used to put something in there all the time. I don't. It's just what it is. So this one's ready to go. Now we'll take this one and again, with trying not to cut myself, simple piece like that. We're just going to get that on there and fold it over to get the seams lined up. Now what you tried not to do here is you can't reuse heat treat foil. Once it's been used, it's done. It's a consumable. It's the cost of making a knife. Don't try and reuse it. As you open it up, you get pinholes in there, and the last thing you want is pinholes. The whole idea around tool wrap is to keep oxygen away from your blade. You can, if you put a blade in without the foil and bring it up to 1950 degrees and soak it for 20 minutes, 25 minutes, bring it back out, quench it, you're going to have a lot of decarb and you'll actually see some delamination and things like that. Now I've left a blade by mistake, I think everyone's done that, in the oven, forgot all about it, came back a couple hours later at 2100 degrees, I was treating some BG42, it was a chunk of charcoal. So that oxygen gets in there combined with that heat, it'll tear it all up. So that's it. Now you want to clean your blade, make sure this has all been cleaned. I've taken this to a final mirror on the blade thing. A lot of guys only take it to 200, 300 grit. I prefer to finish mine because I find it's easier to clean up the patina and get all the way along. So this is cleaned up. Make sure there's no grease, oil, all of that. That's all been cleaned off of this and get that in there. So we got that there now. And we'll fold this over. Tim, I'm going to have you take over. Bill, have you take over and fold this up. I'll do one, and you'll close it up on the edge. So we'll get that folded over. Now, this hammer just seems to work for me. So now you want to smooth it down, get as much air out as you can, because you don't need extra air in there. So I'm going to fold this over once. No blood yet. Good. I'm going to fold it over again, just because I can. Give it a double seal. I'm going to drop that blade down where it'll go, as much as I can, in the pouch. Get that to the edge. Now I'm going to feel where the point is. And we'll take this and trim off any extra. The point is right there, so I'm going to trim that right there and get rid of that extra foil. All right, Tim, go ahead and fold that over once or twice. Don't let the seam overlap the blade. On the flat part of the blade, you don't want any of that seam on there, because when you get that inside of that aluminum plate, you're going to put that flat. Now that blade, of course, has some, this one's hollow ground, and so when you put that plate on there, this plate is actually not going to contact part of the blade, but it draws the heat off so fast, and then with the combination of shooting air in, it's going to be fine. Now keep in mind that a lot of these tool steel, or stainless steels rather, are air hardening. So you can choose not to plate quench and just set it out in still air, and it'll work. That's how these stainless steels are designed, air hardening. Now, the knife makers have picked this up where they're using a plate quench. They'll put that on there nice and flat. It actually helps warping and keeps the blade a bit flatter, and that's been my experience. So we're going to get that out. We're going to take that, shoot cold air in there, compressed air, while we're holding this flat on the flat parts of the blade as they exist now, and that'll be enough to get it quenched. So go ahead and bend that over and we'll get the oven programmed and get going. Good, perfect. I did not double seam that. I used to. I find I don't need to, especially when I'm doing this on there. That seam is pretty tight. There's not going to be a lot of air movement, flexing in and out of the pouch, that kind of thing. So there. Now, some guys will experience an issue with tool wrap sticking to the blade. A little talc powder, if you have that, we'll see what happens here. I've done it both ways. I tend not to do it, and if it does stick, just peel it off. So that's really all there is to that. So we've got two pouches ready to go. We're going to use our even heat oven to heat treat, and then we've got a Paragon oven back here set up to do the temper, because the oven takes a long time to cool off, and we're, you know, just like everybody, we're in a hurry to get the blades done. So let's go and set up over to the even heat, and we'll get this programmed and started. Ready, Bill?
Yes.
Okay, this is an Even Heat 18. This is actually my personal oven I bought about a dozen years ago. And it's been working right along. So these racks that you can get, you can choose to use them or not. They seem to make it easy. Put that in there like that. You can get a couple blades in there, and the practical limit is, you know, how many can you heat treat at once? You're going to open that oven, and you're going to take them out, and then you're going to close it. And how many can you get out in time, fast enough to quench without losing the heat in the oven, and subsequently the heat in this? Two or three is really the practical limit. Now, if you got a couple guys helping you, you'll be able to get a couple more and load this rack up and do as many as you can practically. As you can. Now, when you're putting a long knife in an oven, say you have a big Bowie and it's that long or whatever, you want to stay away from the coils. Now, these ovens all work by turning the coils on full speed for a few seconds, and they cycle, and then they cycle off, and then they do that again, and they're all constantly turning on and off. You're going to hear the relays clicking on and off on these ovens throughout the whole cycle. And what happens is these coils are going to heat up to 2700 degrees, however hot they get. So that the temperature right around those coils is going to be way hotter than the center of the chamber. You always want to put your knife in the center of the chamber. And if you look in here, the K-coupler is right there, the sensor, and you'll see that same thing in the Paragons. So what they measure is the temperature. The controllers measure the temperature in the middle of the oven. They don't measure right by the coils because the coils are way hotter. So when you're sizing for an oven and you're treating big blades, you want to stay an inch or two away from all the coils. Now, this one has coils all the way to the back. So the practical limit on this 18, if you can put your blade in there, let's say this big old set of tongs here is a blade. If you're getting in like that, it will fit. But you're gonna create some issues right here next to this coil. You're going to create issues back there where it's right next to that side. So as you're sizing your oven, you want to be able to stay away from the coils reasonably an inch or two. So like that, you're going to be fine. So the rule of thumb is inch away from all coils, maybe 2 inches if you can get it. Otherwise, that when that coil cycles on and goes burning hot, you don't overheat in that part of the blade. So we got plenty of room here. And we'll put this in there. We got a couple in the racks. Now you can take an old fire brick and cut notches in, that kind of stuff. There's a shelf, kiln shelf that you can buy from a pottery supply and cut notches in, just using a plain old saw, however, or you can use these racks with pins. So we get these in. Now, when this gets up to temperature, don't touch that more than once, because you'll learn not to after a while. These This one has a brass latch, and that's since been upgraded where that's not quite the issue it was, but that'll get really hot. So now this is a Set Pro. It's a three key, and it uses rocker switches to take the temp up. So when you put it on initially, it may come up with a weird error message or that kind of thing, and the answer is just hit enter. Now what to clear that error message. Now what the Set Pro has four memory slots. Four, and what this is saying is we're programming memory slot user 2. So let's change that to user 3. Now we're going to create a memory, a recipe in there in memory slot 3 for this particular heat treat. Now I just, you can put them in there and program and walk away, and then in theory come back and just and hit your memory slot and then hit enter and cycle through until it comes on. And there it's cooking. You hear that click on, but we're not going to do that, so we're going to stop it. So let's go through and we'll program memory slot 3. We'll hit enter. And now it's asking for the number of segments. And that gives you the opportunity to ramp up temperature at a rate that you choose, hold that temperature for the length of time that you choose, and then proceed. So we're going to have two segments in this. Right now it says 3, so I'm going to push that down to 2, and I'm going to hit enter. Now what it's asking you is, how fast should we ramp the temperature? And this is full speed. Now you can set this to go up. Right now I've got it set for 5 degrees per hour. So it would take a billion hours at 5 degrees per hour to get to 1440 degrees is where we're going. Now we can just do this. And we're going to ramp up that oven as fast as it'll heat up until, now there it's saying 1200 degrees. We're going to take that to, and we'll hold that rocker key down, and it'll pick up speed here in a minute. And we're going to get up to 1440 and hold that because that's the one recipe that we're using today. So now we're at 1440 degrees, so it's going to ramp up to that temperature as fast as it can. I'm going to hit enter again, and now it's asking me, how long should I hold that temperature? How long, once we hit 1440 degrees, how long should we stay there? And it says 10 minutes. We'll change it to 11 just because we can, and we'll hit enter. Now it's asking us for the second segment. Remember, we programmed two segments in this. So it says ramp 2, and it's cycling full. And that's what we want to do. So again, we're going to tell the oven, hey, you've been at 1440 for 10 minutes. Now I want you to heat it all the way up to 1950 Fahrenheit. So we're going to hit enter. And there it's defaulted down to 1500 Fahrenheit. So we're going to take that and we'll hold that rocker switch up and take it up to 1950 degrees for this recipe that we're using here. And we'll take that off, and now we'll hit the down and punch that down to 1950 degrees. Bill, once you hit enter, what does it say? Hold for 10. Now we want to soak it for 20. So middle switch, there you go. Rock, hold that and bring that up to 25. Let's soak it for 25 minutes. Now what that does is hold it there, perfect. You want to give the carbon time to get into solution. It takes time. You can't bake a pizza in 30 seconds putting it in a 1,000-degree oven. You can't cook a steak putting it on a 1,000-degree grill. Even though it's really hot, it's not going to be done in the middle. It'll be burned on the outside. It'll be raw on the inside. So it takes a while just for that same reason in steel. As the structure changes, as you heat it, that lattice moves around, and you got to give time for that carbon, those carbides, to become into solution, it's called, and start moving all around the place. And we'll show you a little bit more of that in a minute. But it takes a bit of time. Now, when you look at heat treating data, most of it's around 1 inch, and most of it's around industry, and it's developed for big, thick pieces of steel, and it'll tell you inch per hour and soak time per inch and different things like that. Knives are really thin, so we don't have to deal with that. 20-25 minutes should be more than enough time to do that. And so now we're it went back, whoops, We're going to have to reprogram because it forgot. So we'll go through this and we'll turn it all on. And then we'll step over and take a look at how basic heat treating steel is. Hang in there. Okay, let's talk a little bit about steel and what happens during a heat treat. Now, these little guys are carbides, little pieces of paper, and we'll say the smaller ones are vanadium, and we'll say these other crinkled big pieces of paper are chromium, and there's a big debate about the size of carbides. There's all different kinds of carbides. They're carbon-based, and they combine with different elements, alloys, that kind of thing, to create different sizes of carbides. And that they're very hard, and that's actually what provides the cutting edge, the edge retention, the cutting part of your knife blades. So the carbides do the work, and depending on how many is in the steel, depending upon what type of carbides are in the steel, depending on if they're fine grain, big grain, all of that, you could probably have a couple different carbides inside of your steel lattice. So it's all part of the chemistry of knife steels. And So what you have is, steel is like ice, it's a crystal. It's got lattice in there, and these carbides are locked in to the steel in different ways on a microscopic level. And if you look at carbides under a microscope, they're rough, irregular looking things. They're not perfectly round things like you might expect in some of the models. And so you've got this steel lattice like this, and it's all interlocked, and you got these compounds, and you got covalence and all that history, chemistry stuff that you saw in high school and forgot right away. So as you're heating the steel, what happens is everything starts to get pretty excited. And hold that one open just a little bit there, Tim. And so this is still all connected, but all of a sudden the carbides start coming loose and they're floating around in different ways, and some may get stuck. And the longer you heat it up, the more excited everything gets, and it kind of grows. And all those carbides fall out of the lattice work, okay, and they go into solution. So now you got this steel all excited, it's all worked up, that kind of stuff, and then it's austenite state, and there's perlite and cementite and all that. You know, if you're really into that, you can learn all that, but you don't have to. So now when you quench it, all of a sudden everything kind of collapses down a little bit. And you're actually taking those carbides that are floating all around. They're all over the place, and they're starting to get locked into place. Okay, and I'll set it here, and we'll lock these, pretend like these are locked in. And this steel is not going to lock up all at the same rate. You got some bigger things there and there, and it's not perfect. It's not homogeneous. It's not an exact perfect, there goes the carbide. There's not a perfect lattice, so you have some retained martensite, okay? And this is really fragile, man. It's just stressed out. It's go, ooh, I gotta blow up. I've had blades where I've just sat, taken them out of a heat treat, set them to the side, didn't quite get them in the temper quick enough, heard a tink, and then turn around and see the blade cracked in half. Now, they'll crack around stress risers, that kind of stuff. Guys that forge break blades all the time when they're starting out, not when they get into it and they got it figured out, but if you forge, you're going to break more blades than probably stock removal, stainless, that kind of thing. But so now we've got this steel quenched, and it's kind of, you know, it's gotten tight and that, and it's all stressed out. And we need to relieve some of that stress, and we need to convert the remaining martensite into austenite so it's all kind of uniform and clean that up. So that's where lost another carbide back there. So we've got these carbides floating around and that, and what we want to do when we temper is we want to relax some of that stress between these different elements, and we're going to kind of expand everything and make it more uniform and clean up and remove some of that stress that's built up in that steel. And our high dollar example here will give you that. So that's what happens when you quench. It gets really down, it gets stressed, it's not quite even, there might be grain in there, the lattice might be misaligned, that kind of stuff. And it really builds up internal stress inside of the steel. And so when you temper it, 300, 400, 500 degrees, or 900, depending upon the recipe that you use for heat treat, that's at the expense of corrosion resistance, though usually in that range, you're going to relax some of these molecules, some of that steel, and get it more uniform, clean it up a little bit, and reduces the internal stress and makes it less fragile. Now, cryo is in between the quench, where all that steel's all stressed out, and you put it in liquid nitrogen for 8 hours, or use dry ice, and we're gonna try and find some dry ice or liquid nitrogen here today for this video, and include that in. So we've got that, and what that does is that it's gonna cool everything off, and it's actually gonna convert some of that retained martensite into austenite, which is what we want. And then we'll come back, and there's still stress in there, I'm angry. And so you'll come back, and then you'll still temper a bit after that, kind of relax things, just, you know, chill. You want to chill, Bill?
Yeah, I'll chill.
Okay, and so you get that in there, and again, you can control the hardness, and the hardness comes from that carbon and that carbide that's locked in there, and as you measure the you can adjust that. Now, most knife makers, a lot of stainless guys, end up prefer a 59 HRC, and that's a 59 hardness on the C Rockwell scale. And it's not a perfect number. It's not for everything, and I wish that kind of would go away, because a lot of steels prefer different hardnesses. But 59 is always what comes out. LMAX loves 61 RC, maybe 62. Talked to the factory metallurgist about LMAX. He tells me go 62 every time. I've done 61, 61 and a half on LMAX and some test blades. Handles it fantastic, and you don't get a lot of chippy. Now, the expensive, more hardness, chippier edge, less tough. You get down below 59, 57, 58 range, makes a great fillet knife. Get a little bend in it. Hopefully that bend set, as you bend, for example, a fillet knife, doesn't set and bend the blade, but it should spring back, that kind of thing. So it's all a compromise. Check your heat treat recipes. There's a lot of data online. But that's kind of what happens on heat treating steel. So we're going to take a break. We're going to let our steel cook. When it gets ready to quench, we'll come back. We'll quench it. Then we'll try and find a way to cryo it, whether it's we'll run out and get some nitrogen or get some dry ice or both. We'll throw that in the cryo after the quench. Then we'll temper it, and we'll show you what it's all like when we're done. Hey, thanks for everything. We'll see you in a bit. What do you say, Bill?
Have a great day.
Time for a coat. All right, we're ready to get some welding gloves on. Got the oven. We got 1 minute left on our soak. We're gonna pull this out. Never reach into a charged electrified oven pulling metal out, because lots of times you're holding metal. And if you touch one of those coils, 30 amps, it'll kill you. So that's complete. It's charged off, but I'm gonna make sure that that is all the way down. We've got these tongs. I'm going to reach in. I'm just going to pull out one pouch right now. We'll get it into the small quench plates. We'll cool that off. Then we'll come back and pull the bigger one out and do it in the other quench plates in that. Oven's off. We're safe. Really hot. All right. So get that in flat. That's done. So it's still black hot, but we can cut that out of the foil now. That's as hard as it's gonna get. And so we can take a look at it, but we're gonna do that in a minute. We gotta get that other one out and quench. Tim, I'm gonna have you come. Tommy, come around here and do this other one. Set it right on there nice and flat, as flat. Longer. Keep it flat up. Okay, so that's both of these. Now that'll still burn you if you touch it. You can feel the heat coming off. We'll let that cool off for just a little bit longer. And that one's about cooled off. So now you can see what happens to the foil. It gets pretty used up, and it if you let it go for a real long time, it'll get crunchy and that. But we'll cut that out of the foil. Still hot enough to burn, so I'll be a little careful. It's gonna be fussy. The guy didn't want to come out. There we go. I'm trying not to cut myself on this foil. That foil really sucked up around there, which is kind of common. Didn't stick. It just collapsed itself as there. So we've got that. Hardly any heat treat patina. A little bit around there from some of the available oxygen that was in the envelope. I don't know that you'd eliminate that much. It could have been a small leak, but I doubt it. That's pretty normal for a patina after heat treat. So now, if we drop this on concrete, it'll probably crack, break. Put it in the vise, snap it off real easy. So that's still pretty warm. Just because it's black doesn't mean it's not hot. Now, a lot more heat treat. That is hot. Boy, look at that smoke. So let me cool that a little bit more. Probably warp a blade doing this, but you can see the patina all over this blade, so it probably had a little air leak. Again, we didn't get a lot of the air out. Quite a difference between the finished foil pouch and then just the tool wrap, but this will clean up real fine. It's cosmetic, it's surface deep. You can see where it scratches off really easy. So it's just a very light surface oxidation. It's not gonna hurt the blade at all. So what we're gonna do now is we'll test for hardness on both blades. And we fortunately, we've got two different testing machines here, and we'll show you both of them. We've got a handheld unit, and then we've got a bench mount hardness tester. So we'll test them just for our own information. And CPM 154 at this should test around 61, 62. Then we've got, actually, we've got two different ways to cryo these. We went out, we ran out while this was heat treating. We got a block of dry ice and some RV antifreeze, and we'll put one in there. And then we got our Duar filled up with some liquid nitrogen, and put the other one in there. We're gonna let them soak for a while. We'll come back and check the hardness again after the cryo treatment. And we should see about a point, point and a half increase on the average in the hardness on the C scale. Then after that, we'll temper them twice at 400 for 2 hours each. So we'll put them in the temper oven, run them for 400. We can just take it out, let it cool off to room temperature, and you can put it right back in. Once that in between the temper cycles, put it right back in at 400 for another 2 hour session, and we're gonna land right at 59 to 60 HRC with that particular recipe. So let's head over and give it a hardness test on both machines. Okay, we're ready to do some hardness testing. This is a Wilson brand portable, and this is a dimple test. There's different ways to measure hardness. Basically what this does, and most hardness testers that knife makers use, put a little dimple mark in it, and then they press a little bit more and make a deeper dimple in the same one, in the same spot, measure the difference, and that converts into a hardness reading. So usually you want to put a mark, and if you send off a blade for heat treat, and if they're doing their job right, and most of them do, you'll see a mark. In fact, some of Paul Baugh's, before he retired, I'm not sure if his replacement still does, put little arrow marks showing the dimple mark that the hardness was tested. You want every blade tested that, and if you're going to heat treat your own, you really want to invest in a hardness checker. So we're going to put this in, and I'm going to have to switch it around because I did it the first time, messed it up. And I'm going to see what I'm doing. So basically, I'll tell you what, we'll get that in there and we'll tighten that up. It's clamped in there good. Okay, and so I'm going to turn that to set. Now I've got this dial moved, the A dial moved to set, and I've got the B dial that we ignore that for a minute. Now I'm going to tighten. Now it's tightening up a little bit more. And so now it's gone from the dot to the set. I'm going to reset this dial right here to zero. See what I'm doing? I'm going to tighten this all the way up to the C scale, because that's what we're measuring. And there's that. Now I'm going to back it off to the set. And come up a little high on this. That's surprising. We're actually measuring 63 HRC. So we had a real good quench. That's a little bit high from my experience in CPM 154. Normally, though, you take three measurements and average them. And that's just good industry practice for heat treat. So let's run one more, and then we'll step over to the other machine, and we'll show you that one. Loosen it all up, we'll put it on a new dot. Quick tighten, back to set, and we're still gonna get that high reading. We're still at, that one actually came in higher at 64. So great quench there. And that is a Wilson. There's Ames. There's other ones that are out there, other brands, several different brands, but that's how these things work. In a nutshell, they're all a variation on that. They put a dimple in, then they put a deeper dimple in and read it off. So now let's step over and I'll show you the bench model that we have here in the shop. Does the exact same thing, just on a bigger scale. A little faster, and it doesn't take three hands. All right, Toby, so
Tim.
So what we do on on these is same thing as the other one. Basically, we're going to tighten it up, and this brings the ram up the table. And what we're looking for is this dial to be vertical, and there's a tiny little dial right here, and it goes from a black dot to a red dot. So we're going to just tighten that up. Big dial spins around. The very little dial is moving and moves to about a quarter to the 9 o'clock position. And once we hit that, we want this needle to be vertical. And we'll be right there. And so then there's a knob here, and that's the loading knob. So we'll pull that, wait a second. And now it unloads, and it's measuring the distance. So this needle is backing off, the pressure's coming loose. And so once it stops moving, we hit the unload knob and come up with our reading. Now this one is at 59.5, okay? So again, you take an average of your readings. We'll back this off. And that's why you take three, because these readings are really not unusual to vary this much. It's probably me operating them that way. I did go a little past and then back, and that's not a good practice. So we're gonna just do that. All right, we're on the red. The small dial is on the red dot. Large dial is vertical. Hit the unload. Takes a second for the oil to discharge inside there. Dial's resetting. I can see now we're going to get a lot higher reading. We're going to end up around 62. And we came up at 62.5. So besides that first bad reading I did on that, we had a 63, we had a 64, we have a 62.5. We're going to call it around a 63 RC. Real common to take three different measurements on different parts of the blade to get a variation of 1 to 2 HRC on that. So we're going to call that a 63. Now we're going to drop it in the liquid nitrogen, or the dry ice in this case, and we'll drop the other blade in liquid nitrogen. We'll let them soak till tomorrow, and then we'll come back tomorrow. We'll measure the RC again. This one probably won't pick up a lot of hardness. It might pick up a half a point to a point, get up to 64 or so, and then we'll temper them back. Okay, so let's head over and throw them into cryo. All right, Tom. So we got this. Yeah. We're gonna put this in. We've got this big chunk of dry ice. We bought it for about $20 at the gas welding supply store. If you're looking for dry ice in your town, chances are your welding gas supply store is going to have it. We also bought liquid nitrogen there, and we've got a Dewar here, and we'll show you that next. We paid about $20 for the dry ice. It was about $10 or 10 pounds, something like that.
10
right?
pounds.
$20, a little high. Lots of times you get dry ice free. Tim's wife works at the hospital, and they get it every day and give it away. They don't, you know, it's just one of those things. But we ran out and got this for the video. We've got a 30-liter Dewar for liquid nitrogen. Had them fill that up, and I think that was $67. So now this dry ice is going to be gone tomorrow. That liquid nitrogen, our Dewar, I just happen to know that it'll last a few weeks. We're going to put it in an insulated container that I have to help last it. 4 weeks, but 4 weeks it's going to be gone. That's just how long my Dewar holds. You can bid it. You can buy a Dewar. I bought mine used on eBay for $100-$200 a long time ago. Again, that's another thing that knife makers have been getting after, and driven the price up. So you're going to see those on. They're all over eBay, but they're going to cost you a little bit more. So 30 liter I found is too big. I don't need a 30 liter. It's crazy big, but didn't know the difference at the time. You know, bigger is not always better in this case, but you can probably get by with a 10 liter and talk to your gas supply store guy and try and get a deal out of them. They don't sell a lot of liquid nitrogen to walk-in people. That tell them your business, otherwise they may not even sell to you. So what we're going to do on this, there's two schools of thought on cryo. You can treat it with dry ice, which we're going to do, and we're going to use RV antifreeze. It's non-toxic. Okay, a lot of guys on the net started off talking about using dry ice and acetone. Acetone blow you up, man. And then kerosene came up, a little less flammable, but smelly, still flammable. And then figured out RV antifreeze is the way to go. It'll get gunky and all that, but it's not going to blow up and it's non-toxic. So we'll put this in, and then we'll drop the dry ice in. You don't need a lot. You're just trying to get a conductor going between the dry ice and the blade. And this isn't real high science. Now, there's a lot of people that scoff at cryo treatment. I did a lot of research on it. And while there's apparently a lot of hucksters out there that are out to take your money and tell you to cryo treat anything from hairbrushers to guitar strings because, you know, it'll work better, doesn't necessarily be the case. But the science is kind of solid, I think. Solid enough to do it. And we certainly see the difference in the HRC as we measure the blades before and after. And so you're going to help convert some of that retained martensite. Didn't convert perfectly when we quenched to austenite, and that's why we're going to do it. So we got that. Got a little bit in there, and we got a big box of dry ice. Hope that fits. Don't want to touch it, get burned, Tim. I'll have you give me a hand up. Maybe just turn it over, huh? Good. Pull that away. Hope it fits. Yeah, it's not gonna. Hammer. This is awesome. Bill Nye, tell us about this. What's that song? Right, so. We're gonna start running around the shop here looking for bananas and stuff to put in this dry ice pretty soon. And we're gonna set that outside. God, it looks great, doesn't it?
And then,
we'll set this outside and let it do its thing until the dry ice is gone. Then we'll come back and measure how it's going. So, see you in a bit. Okay, I said earlier that you're converting retained martensite to austenite. That's wrong. You're going for martensitic steel, so you're converting retained austenite to martensite. Sorry about that. But a mouth typo. So we've got this liquid duar. Bought it used. They're commonly used for bull semen all over the place, and that's where you find most of them. So bought this used. That way you can get them. That way, no. To do this, you just take plain old stovepipe wire or whatever you got, and we're just going to put this blade and wrap it. Now you definitely don't want to use some kind of cable or something that's going to snap and you lose your blade in the, got skeeters in here, and lose the blade in the bottom of your jug. Then you got to pour it out to get your jug out, to get your blade out. So our sophisticated top is a blue mat that now this is going to continue to bubble and smoke and make all kinds of stuff. Now we're going to put this in slow, and we're just going to let it rest on the bottom. And I've never cracked a blade. This way I've lost one blade tip doing this. And you can hear it, maybe. Okay, so. We're back. So that's it, and there we go. So that's cooling off now. Liquid nitrogen is supposed to be 296 minus Fahrenheit, probably something less than that because it's boiling away the whole time it's in there. And like I said earlier, this duar will last me about 4 weeks. We're going to put it back in, we're going to lift this in, put it in our coal box, and let that sit. And so now we've got both of them cooling off, and in the morning we're going to check the hardness on both of them. We should see an improvement. I don't think we measured this one, but we'll can see what that result temperature is so far, or the hardness in the morning. So we'll see you tomorrow. Thanks. Okay, we're back. It's overnight. We had the blades in liquid nitrogen and dry ice, so we'll see what's up. This is our dry ice bucket. Most of the dry ice is evaporated, and the RV antifreeze is still a little slushy, so we'll set this out in the sun for just a little bit and get this to melt away. Plenty of there, so set that over there. Then we'll and there's our other blade. Now we'll let this hang a little bit and return to room temperature before we set it down and thermal shock it anywhere. It's 280 below. Go ahead and touch it, Tim. Lick it.
No, thank you.
Put your tongue in there. So no.
No.
All right. We'll let this get back to room temp, and then we'll pop them in the oven, 400 degrees at 2 hours. Let it cool back to room temp, and another 400. When this gets back to room temp and we get that other one thawed out of that block there, we'll run a hardness test, see where we're at. We should have added a point or two on that one. We didn't measure this one because it's a Bali, and we didn't want to put a mark on the blade because it'll all be showing. So we'll check that other one, and then we'll get them in, and we'll see you in a bit. Okay, we're back. Both blades are back to room temperature now. I just did some hardness tests on this one. It came out around 62.5, 63. So we didn't gain a lot in the cryo, and this was in the dry ice. But we had said that earlier, that this had quenched pretty completely, and there probably wasn't a lot of austenite retained to convert to martensite. So I did not expect a big jump in this one. And it didn't. It's still right around, we're going to call it a 63 RC. So this Bali blade we didn't do because we didn't put any marks on it. This one was in the liquid nitrogen. We'll get them in the oven now. And these don't require foil. We just set them in there and two cycles at 400, 2 hours each. Well, so we'll turn this on. We'll run it for 2 hours. It'll shut itself off. We'll take them out with this, and we don't even need to let the oven cool down. We'll just take them out. They need to get back to room temperature. We put them back in, and then we'll check them after all that. So we'll see you in 4 hours. Okay, we have gone through both tempers, 2 hours, 400 degrees, twice, let it cool off. Dustin's already cleaned up his Bali blade a bit and got that patina off. I haven't finished mine yet. This came out at 60 RC, a little harder than I was probably shooting for, but I'm gonna live with that. It's just fine. I could put it in for another cycle at 425, probably take a point out, but the difference between 59 and 60 is not a deal breaker. We'll just leave it there and it'll have a little better cutting edge. So that's all we've got today for you. Appreciate your time. We want to thank Bob Nye, the science guy. And we'll see you on the next one. Thanks for your business, and catch you on Knife Talks. Have a good one. Okay. Now step in and give us a click on that. Ready? Right here. You can reach over and do it right here in front of me. Okay. Chrome carbides, vanadium carbides, steel lattice, Bill Nye.
Bill Nye.
Bill Nye. Thanks, Bob.
Bob. Jeez, mine's going to cost a lot.
And their signature mechanisms, you're going to find mechanisms around autos, spring assists, traditional trappers, all of that.